and welcome to the broadcast. We begin tonight with Duf Sundheim, who's the former chairman of the California Republican Party, and he was so during the whole recall and the election of Arnold Schwarzenegger as governor. He's currently a member of the governor's California Dream Team and engaged in long-term political projects. Welcome, Duf.
Arthur, thanks for having me on the show.
We are, we have been in the trenches before.
A long time.
It's like old World War II or maybe Vietnam vets getting together and talking about old times, but there's a lot that has happened. And first, I want to congratulate you on the incredible job you did. We know we have Democratic viewers. We understand that. But there's a lot of Republicans, too. But I don't want to lose Democratic viewers. The problems of the Republican Party are very similar to the problems of the Democratic Party. There's a left, there's a right, and there's people in the middle. You were in the middle. How did you first manage to bring everyone together to vote for your candidacy? And then what did you do after you became chair to keep both sides productive and engaged?
Well, we were in a really difficult time, and when you're facing a difficult time, it's easier to bring people together. The state was on the brink of bankruptcy. Governor Davis had passed the car tax, so that was creating some problems. So it was at a time when you could bring people together. And then you had the governor who was actually doing things. So when you have somebody moving the ball forward, it's easier to keep the troops together.
You were you won a couple of letters as a football player too.
A long time ago. Did I use several sports analogies?
Well, the point is, I'm actually wondering whether or not. Look, I remember I saw a quote where you said that you were going in to become chair. You thought you had 16 out of 17 endorsements. You found out that you had very few endorsements right at the last minute. So I'm still curious. Let's go back before we get into the national, local politics and state politics. How did you convince the right? And how did you convince the left in the party, who've been warring for many years, that you could be a candidate for both of them?
Well, we focused on winning. And, you know, I went to somebody that their number one issue was abortion. I talked to them for an hour about and just listened to the things that were important to them. They never brought up abortion. I never brought up abortion. The guy said, okay, you got my endorsement. And the guy that set up the meeting said, but, Dick, you never asked them about
abortion.
Why
didn't they ask you?
And he says, You know, Jimmy, sometimes there are things more important than a particular issue. And this is the future of the state that we're talking about.
But you didn't have Arnold Schwarzenegger at that time.
No, we did not.
You didn't even know about Warner.
No, they didn't know. But there was enough hunger out there. And that's what the governor fed into.
Davis.
Governor Schwarzenegger fed into it and was able to ride it. And there was that sense in the state that, you know what, we need to take a risk. We know we're going to be going over the cliff if we go in the same direction. You know, his numbers were locked at about 23% until they had that debate. And he stood up on the stand and interacted with Huffington and Cruz Bustamante, and he showed that he could be the governor. And that's when his numbers went from 22 up to 47, because they said, you know what, we know we're going down the wrong path. We're reluctant to change horses. Then when they saw him in the debate, they said, ha, this is a guy who actually can do things, and that's when we were off and running. But when I was running for chair, which you're right,
yeah,
was before all that, I really thought I'd go in and I'd find this everybody locked into these ideological boxes.
Mm-hmm.
And that wasn't the case. They were ready. They were hungry enough and knew that the future of the state was involved. So they were willing to put aside what had been their number one issues for what they thought was the future of the state. And frankly, the governor and I were pretty much in sync as to what our vision of the future of the state would be.
Okay. What about now? I mean, what happens now? Because this governor will be gone.
Right.
And what was left before, which is a dominated Democratic Assembly and Senate, is going to be still waiting for you. In other words, I was also going to ask you, maybe we should do this one first. Had Schwarzenegger not run for governor, what were your plans to change things?
Well, I think that we were hoping to build things a piece at a time. And I think that looking towards the 2010 election, we were hoping that we would have more of a united party. I mean, so many things have happened between now and then. You know, at that time, it was before the war in Iraq. And so when
yes,
I talked with Rove and what his plans were for the Republican Party, they were much different than they turned out to be. He was really going to be much more progressive on their domestic agenda. But when they had the problems with the Iraq war, it became, okay, we have to nail down the base. So the national scene went completely bad on us as far as California was concerned.
Do you think that they would have, if there had been no war, yeah, and by that I mean the unpopularity of it,
right,
especially,
right,
that California was going to be a major target for the president's re-election campaign?
I don't know if California would have been a major target, but they were going to come out with, you know, the compassionate side of the compassionate conservative. Definitely would have gotten more play than it did. You would not have seen the emphasis on gay rights, flag burning, and all that sort of stuff, which was all designed to nail down the base. You would have seen Bush, I believe, go much more for the middle in the 2004 campaign.
All right, so now here's where you are. You leave the chairmanship. The governor is a Republican.
Right.
What's going to be left now in 2010 that's hopeful for any Republicans that are out there and probably very pleased for the Democrats out there? Is there any hope? I mean, there's such domination in the state by the Democratic Party.
Well, there is and there isn't. I mean, if you look back in the history, the governor has been a Republican for what? 17 in the last 24 years. So, you know, they're at the legislative level, you're going to have Democrat domination for a whole bunch of reasons. And as you know, but it may be difficult for the viewers to totally comprehend, when you do the census, which divides up what the districts are, it's based on population, not on voters. And so that heavily favors the Democrats because there are a lot of people in Democratic districts that just don't vote. So you tend to have a lot more districts that are heavily Democratic. So that gives them disproportionate representation. I think if you look out at 2010, for the Republican perspective, the bad news is there are a high number of qualified Democrats running. The good news is there's a high number of qualified Democrats running. And I think what the goal of the Republican Party would be is to identify somebody who's able to capture the imagination of the people the way Schwarzenegger has. People in California like to have somebody that has their foot on the accelerator, which is the legislature, the progressiveness, but they also like to have somebody that has their foot on the brake. Mm-hmm. And that's what you need the Republican governor to do. And so if we're able, whether it's Steve Poizner or somebody else, mm-hmm. that is able to show that they're responsible but compassionate, I think that that Republican will have a good chance of winning. And one of the projects I'm working on is working with the potential candidates for governor right now to make sure that they understand what the issues are, understand how to do campaigns, so that when we get to 2010, we'll be ready to compete.
Much talk is made, though, of the more conservative side of the Republican Party that did accept Schwarzenegger and did accept you,
right.
Because you're sort of in somewhere in another place. I know you personally, and I don't know where you are.
You know, but I hope your viewers don't.
So the fact is, that you're very the skills that you have are the skills that I see Republican candidates needing both to win on the future, on the national level and on the state level. I don't know how you handled all these issues, but we do know that the extreme left of the Democratic Party is haunting their candidates.
Yes.
The right side haunts our candidates, and thus there's primaries, and they generally go to the primaries.
But the thing that people don't understand about our party, Arthur, is the importance that Republicans place on leadership. And that's why Giuliani keeps confounding the people that seem to want to take the position that, oh, Republicans, they're ideological. No, we think ideas are important and we think values are important, but more important, we will follow a leader. And Giuliani has shown those leadership skills. So I think that's a key difference. And that the other thing is both what the governor has done and what I tried to do, mm-hmm. is, you know, again, the ideological stuff is one thing, but be of service to people. Because if you really are responsive to the needs of their community, you know, education, transportation, water, if you address the issues that are important to people, that's really important too. So I would say leadership and getting things done that make a difference in their lives.
Is the state and is the country, and especially is the South, ready for that approach? I mean, Pat Robertson endorse Rudy
right.
Giuliani.
Right. Well, I think what you're seeing,
I mean,
there,
we're seeing anomalies here.
You are. But that's, I think that's more due to the fact that the conservatives had two candidates that they were going to run in 2008, Bill Frist and George Allen. Both of those, Bill Frist dropped out early, and Allen got, Mankata?
He self-destructed.
Yeah,
How's
he self-destructed. So there's no candidate there. So you're seeing a splintering. But that is not over. What we're trying to do here in California is come up with a new vision of what it means to be a Republican. You know, if you look at what Reagan did. He started in 1964. I'm down at the Hoover Institute going through these files on this. He started out with a concept in 1964 that didn't bear fruit until 1980. We don't need to go back and develop that same profile because the country is tremendously different than it was back in that time. But we have to come up with that new idea. And I think the Republicans are in the process of
developing it. What do you think that
is? The concept is we do big things that don't increase the power of government, but increase the power of the individual. And that's what Republicans, when we've been at our best, that's what we've always done. Look at Alexander Hamilton. He created the U.S. Bank. Was that to create more power in the government? Mm-hmm. No, it created an entire merchant class. Abraham Lincoln, Transcontinental Railway. Was that to increase the power of government? No, it opened up the whole plain states for the agricultural class. Teddy Roosevelt, the antitrust laws, was that to increase the power of government? No, it created the middle class. Eisenhower, the interstate transportation network, was that to increase the power of government? No, it enabled us to get around. And what we need to do now is use modern technology, which has given us the keys to the kingdom, which it can put the individual in the center of their lives as opposed to government.
Within a political campaign.
You can
address that campaign.
You can address that within a... And here's the personification of it. I was with Meg Whitman, president of eBay in Boston. This 35-year-old man clearly had not been successful in life. And he had a bunch of badges on his chest that showed he had been successful at eBay. And he said, Meg, how does it make you feel to know that you've made millions of people successful? And Meg said, I haven't made you successful. It's your hard work that made you successful. We just gave you the tools. And that's what we need to do. We need to take the tools that are available to us today and use the government to provide those to the individuals so they can have richer and
fuller
lives.
Do you think a Democrat would say anything different?
Yes. I think that their first reaction is that government is the solution to the problem, and whereas the Republicans see that it's up, the role of the government is to help the individual realize their individual dream.
Well, I know, but that is I'm going to say, a bit idealistic. I mean, when you start getting down to real issues,
yes.
The Democrats would have solutions. It may not be solutions that you find attractive, but when it comes to health care, education, and so on, they have solutions, and it does involve a very active government role. In fact, Robert Novak was asked, and I think he's written a book that's just come out, that the era of Reagan is over, and he was asked on this program, does he think the country is moving to the left, which means government intervention? Mm-hmm. And it is his opinion that the public is ready now in the normal cycle to move back to giving the government a chance to solve some of these problems that apparently are still there and not solved by the free market or by individuals or reformed government. What's your comment on that?
Well, I think he's done a great job over his life, but I'm not surprised that an 80-year-old person doesn't have a new vision of what we can do for ourselves. Clearly, we have new problems that have not been addressed over the last 20 years. And our natural inclination is to just say, well, let government do it. But, you know, we talked about...
Let's do this.
Yeah.
We're going to take a break.
Great.
And we'll come right back. Stay with us. We will be right back. And welcome back. We're talking with Duf Sundheim, who's the former chairman of the Republican Party. We're talking about, especially for our Republican viewers, we don't do programs.
We could probably fit them all in this studio.
There's actually 50,000 in here. One of them actually asked me is, they vote more, there's more propensity to vote by Republicans, both statewide and in the local races. Does that give them, and what kind of a boost does that give them in an average election? Do they get an extra 2-3 points or 4 points over registration?
5% is the rule of thumb. But, you know, every once in a while we have an election that changes everything. In 2006, you just throw out all those numbers. Because nationwide, they say like 8% of the people are in play. Well, in 2006, 18% were in play. So
we're talking about independent voters.
And moderate Republicans and conservative Democrats.
That band in the middle that decides the election.
Blew up, yeah.
And that's true even in the presidential race. There's a band in there.
That's
there?
Right. And what I'm saying, over the last few years, it's been perceived that that's around 8%.
Yes.
But in 2006, it went to 18%.
What do you think will be next year and also in the state of California? The decline of states is growing in California.
It's 20% and growing.
And this city, it's the highest.
Yes.
At the expense mostly of the Democratic Party.
Right. But you can't say those are going to the middle. No. A lot of those, especially in San Francisco, are going to the green. Left.
Yeah. We were, you know, I want to stop, although we're going to come back to it. I want you to look at the Democratic Party. Sure. Do they have the same problem? Are they doing the same thing?
Well, I think they had a real opportunity in 2006 to really grab the bull by the horns, and I think that they failed to do that. I mean, they're 0 for 40 on the war in Iraq, and I think that their view was, well, we're going to be painting the Republicans into a corner by showing that they're obstructionists, but I just think that they've shown that they're ineffective, and that's why as low as the president's approval rating is, theirs is even lower. So I think they need to come up with a justification for where they're going to take the country, and right now they don't seem to have that.
But I mean, when you... and I don't listen to the presidential debates on their side.
Right.
No, I actually did watch one. are they struggling with the? Are they struggling to cast off that liberal left that's held them back, like the extreme right has often held back the Republican Party, because they believe passionately in their issues? I mean, they are passionate about their issues, so they put pressure on them. Are they taking the same route that you were describing to develop a new model for new problems, or are they still going back to an FDR or big government?
Yes, exactly, primarily. Although the interesting thing is, in the one place that they've broken out is with respect to Hillary's health care plan. The similarities between her plan and the governor's plan are very close. But if you look at where they're going in terms of, in general, in terms of health care, in general, in terms of education, in general, in terms of trade, they're retrenching. And Arthur, as you well know, this is a completely different world now. And the role of government is significantly less in its ability to control our lives than it was many years ago. I mean, right now, if you don't like what the government tells you to do in North Carolina, you just go to India or you go to Ireland or whatever. So the role of government is now primarily to protect its people from external threats and to protect them in the community. But this concept that through trade barriers or raising wages that you can protect people's jobs, that decision has already been made. That ship has sailed, but yet the Democrats are still trying to
hold on. They have to. Their constituency is there.
Exactly right. But that's a recipe for failure. And so the question for this country is, are we going to be the England of the 1960s, where everything was controlled by unions and where it failed? Or are we going to be the England of the 1980s under Margaret Thatcher, who has created an incredible boom? You know, I would say that the country that's doing the best in the world today, outside the United States and China, is England, and it's because of Maggie Thatcher's
policies. Well, I have to take you out of the realm that you just went to.
That's all right. I don't think too many people
the Democrats just turned you off because that was a political campaign speech. What I'm saying is I want you to step back as a strategist. I want to talk about the Democratic Party from an objective point of view. Are they attempting to at least avoid being caught up in extreme positions? In other words, showing that moderation, showing that flexibility that you're talking about. I mean, if the Republicans are going to veer off of these extreme paths that they've been noted for, are the Democrats going to attempt to do the same thing and are trying to do something? I mean, are there governors and people you come across who are Democratic that are trying to be flexible, are trying to move to the same place you think you want to see the Republican Party move?
I haven't seen that, and I'm saying that with all due respect. I mean, I have a good relationship with Art Torres, and we get together on a regular basis, but I don't think the Democrats have been forced to do that, because we have made it relatively easy for them, because all they have to say is, we're against Bush. You know, they don't have to do anything else, and so the argument gets to be, who's more against Bush than the other guy, rather than what are my new ideas and how am I going to take this country forward? So, you know, this election is all about change. And the candidate, whether it's Hillary, Barack, Giuliani, Romney, it's all going to be who's going to be able to make the most change from where we are today. And that, I think, is the person that's going to win this election.
The presidential race.
The presidential race, right. But when you get to the governing side of things, I don't see that new set, that understanding within the Democratic Party as to where the world is going. Now, at the same time, and for your Democratic viewers, Republicans aren't addressing that either. The only thing that we're saying is we're for the war on terror. We are offering, at the presidential level, no vision of where this country is going. Washington, from a congressional standpoint, is just a pool of inaction right now. Where the action is happening is places like Schwarzenegger in California, Chris in Florida, Minnesota, Utah. There are some bright young governors that are coming up with some new and creative
ideas. Democrats?
No, you know, it's interesting. The Democrats haven't done that. And when a Democratic governor does do that, they become president, you know, whether it's Jimmy Carter or Bill Clinton. But if you look, since 1961, I think it's something like 70 sitting senators have run for the presidency. Not one has won.
There's talk that the Senate, that the Democrats will elect enough senators to have a veto-proof power over the Republican.
They're definitely running downhill. We're definitely running uphill.
Could that, if that happens, then would you see, if it was a Republican president, totally powerless to prevent the same measures that a Democratic president would enact?
Well, when you say unable to prevent, I think what's possible to happen, and who knows whether it will, they'll have a majority in the House, and they could have the 60 votes in the Senate, which would enable them to pass legislation. But they still would have to get to two-thirds in both houses to override a veto. So I think that it would be up to, you know, what Nancy... And
you don't see that many losses then? That enough?
I don't see that. I don't see them getting two-thirds either house.
But, okay, we have this optimistic view that we're going to come back to now that you were talking about, that you're working on. You're working on with whom? With what other kinds of people are working?
Well, I just got off the phone with somebody that's running for the Assembly, and we were running through these ideas and putting together seminars for candidates that are running for office at the Assembly level, city council level, mayors.
Really? And what are you telling them?
The concept is that the role of government is to increase hope and opportunity on the individual level. And the difference that we are from, the difference we're trying to make from the existing system, look at the control that the teachers union have over the educational process. We need to take away the power from the teachers union and put the individual at the center of their educational experience. With modern technology and the web and everything, right now, if a kid in South Central, if it takes him 5 years to get through, quote, third grade, why don't we do that? Why don't we, you know, instead of having it be such a negative experience for him for 12 years, when he gets out and he goes, there's nothing for me in this society, why not develop a program for him from day one that everything he accomplishes, we go, hey, congratulations. Now let's move on to the next step. We have that capability, but the institutions
don't. Yeah, but you're not suggesting
that
Democrats or Democratic candidates want to see that child abandoned.
No, but they're saying they want the teachers' union to have total control.
Well, I know, but...
And they want to have an institution. And what we have to do is break it away from having the institution having the power to empowering the individual.
Do you think, though, that... all the odds are against... Right today, all the odds are against us at the state level. San Francisco is hopeless, as you know. Right. There are no elected officials that are Republican here. The state, we see the possibility of losing even more seats. We see the loss of seats in Congress and in the Senate. And we see a great chance that we'll lose the presidency. Now, in face of that, what you're talking about is a wonderful, ideal program. Don't you think that the Republican Party is going to eventually have to go into crisis mode if that all happens next year?
I think we're there. If you look what's going on, I mean, you will see another major Republican congressman that will announce that he's retiring shortly.
How many are there? There's 12 already, isn't there?
Yes, and you'll see others. I mean, so we're already...
Six senators are retiring, Republicans.
That's correct. That's correct.
And all those are open seats.
Those are correct.
We're defending 12 seats, 24 seats in the Senate. They're only defending 12.
Right.
Everything that could go wrong next year. And what happens then?
Well, then, you know, it's up to, and the Democrats, and, you know, since I'm an American first, I hope they're successful. And I hope they do a great job. And then maybe we're out of power for a long period of time. And if our country's better off because of that, that's fantastic. But again, I view this as we're like 1964 when Reagan came up with his policies in 1980. So what we have to do is...
And I may add, Goldwater lost miserably, didn't he?
Exactly.
I mean, really miserably.
And that is kind of like, there's this book that I read in college that really got me thinking about it. It's called The Promise of the Coming Dark Age. Is that, you know, you have to go through that cathartic collapse before you can build something new. And I think we're at that point. Now, it also happened, if you remember, Nixon beat Humphrey in 68, but that wasn't with a new ideology. That was just that the Democrats got too far off on the left and splintered.
And the war.
And splintered. So, you know, you do have to develop that type of idea. So you have to find A candidates, you have to have A ideas, and you have to sell your message to the public over a long period of time.
Okay, we only have a couple minutes left. Yeah. We're going to end on that where we left off. That is, here you were, mm-hmm. here Arnold Schwarzenegger was, and here Giuliani, they are not your prototype Reagan Republicans, right. Okay? We don't know what they are, and you're saying that you are moving, we think we're moving towards something that's beyond the Reagan, not in a disrespectful way, but there are new problems, new issues.
Right. So here are the Reagan two, wouldn't be Reagan today.
Reagan would, that's right, yeah. Okay. So what you three did in creating a model that is neither left or right, certainly pragmatic, and this model of a Republican that may be necessary if we lose everything next year, how is that going to happen, that evolution? You think it's going to happen by people making decisions, or do you think you and your group can actually push along this process of revamping the new Republican?
Well, because we're not doing it as Republicans. I mean, you know, if you talk with Schwarzenegger, he doesn't see this as a red state or a blue state. You know, I'm the chairman of the party. I don't think we've ever talked about the future of the Republican Party. We've always talked about the future of the state. And I think that's what you try to do. If you're a real leader, you're not just looking at it from the perspective of what helps me win elections, it's what helps people. And I think the voters are smart enough to pick up on that. So as long as Giuliani, Schwarzenegger, and in whatever small role I can play, focus on the issues that affect people, then we'll be successful. And if we focus on what's in it for us or what's in it for our party, we won't.
So you're saying that as this decline to state independent voter base starts to grow, wherever they are,
right,
and whatever their leanings,
right,
and the parties then lose a lot of what has been the game for the last maybe 100, 200 years, we're moving into problem solving rather than parties.
I think so. I think people are getting smart enough that they don't just accept banners.
Are impatient?
Well, no. They don't just have to accept, okay, I'm buying a Ford or a Chevy. You know, you got 12 different things out there,
right,
and you have to be sophisticated enough to be able to address
those. But pragmatism concerns seems to be one of the focuses.
I think there's more room for that today.
All right,
hopefully.
That's hopeful. Duf Sunheim, thanks for being with us.
Thanks for having me on.
Hope you enjoy tonight's program, especially you Democrats, and we'll see you next time.
That are still there.
For program schedules, post-production notes, and free streaming video of select interviews, visit our website at www.sfunscripted.com.